I'm Eric Anderson. Tonight on KPBS Evening Edition, another night of protest planned in San Diego's City Heights neighborhood over a grand jury decision in Missouri. The demonstrations even spread to Interstate 5 in La Jolla, right in the middle of the morning commute. And a San Diego lawmaker wants workers to get double time for working on Thanksgiving and Christmas. We'll have a look at the proposal.
Holidays are supposed to be an enjoyable time, but for many, the season increases anxiety, depression, and other mental health issues. I'm Peggy Pico with expert tips to avoid holiday blues. Then, Marine Room chef Bernard Guillas joins us with how to make your Thanksgiving feast sizzle for traditionalists, vegetarians, and heart-healthy guests. KPBS Evening Edition starts now.
Good evening and thanks for joining us. Dwayne Brown is off this week. Protesters are gathering again tonight in City Heights for another night of demonstrations against a grand jury decision in Missouri. That panel decided not to charge a white police officer for shooting and killing a black teenager. Tonight's demonstration is supposed to start in a short while. KPBS reporter Megan Burks joins us by phone from the scene. Megan, give us a sense of where you're at and what you're seeing right now.
Yeah, I'm at the Jeremy Henwood Memorial Park on Fairmont Avenue and Landy Street in City Heights. It is picking up. There are about 60 to 100 demonstrators here. There are police on the street and then also in the park, but keeping their distance from the demonstrators. Demonstrators are actually sort of confronting a line of police who are in riot gear. It is a peaceful confrontation. They're saying, hands up, don't shoot. And they're beginning to march on to the streets of City Heights.
So this is the second night of demonstrations in the City Heights area. Why is this all happening in City Heights?
City Heights is a very diverse community. It's one of San Diego's most diverse. It's also home to a lot of activist groups. Activist San Diego has its home here. And so it's just kind of a gathering place for folks who want to make a statement about civil rights and social justice.
And what do we expect to happen later tonight? Have you had any clue? Have you had a chance to talk to anyone?
We're not quite sure what's going to happen. Right now, the group is marching onto the street. We're not sure if they're going to march onto the freeway like they did last night. Organizers did remind people to be smart and to be peaceful. So it looks like they're just heading onto the streets to make their comments and feelings known.
That is KPBS reporter Megan Burks reporting live from City Heights today. Now, this morning, protesters blocked part of Interstate 5 in La Jolla. Those protesters brought rush hour traffic to a standstill. It happened about 7 a.m. this morning. You can see there that they are blocking all traffic on Interstate 5. Cars, of course, backed up for miles. Some commuters actually got out of their cars and confronted the protesters. Highway Patrol officers convinced the demonstrators to leave the roadway without actually arresting anyone. Now, the protest continued on city streets, monitored by San Diego police. Those officers were wearing body cameras to record their interactions with the public. Today, Police Chief Shelley Zimmerman told KPBS Midday Edition that she might release a body cam video in case it might help public safety. She says the police shooting in Ferguson is an example of such a case.
I would likely, something like that would happen here, would release that film for everyone to be able to see, although my policy is that we don't release it to the public.
Now, hundreds of protesters are marching in downtown Los Angeles as well tonight. And there was also a march at City Hall in St. Louis, Missouri. But in Ferguson, where it all began, it is relatively quiet so far, and people are beginning to clean up after the violence today. Now, we are going to have continuing coverage of this story. You'll be able to hear it tomorrow morning on KPBS Radio from 5:30 to 9 a.m. We'll also have coverage on KPBS Television, the News Hour. At 7 p.m., we'll have extended coverage of what's going on. And you can find updates, of course, on our website, kpbs.org. We'll be back with the rest of the day's news in just a moment. Chula Vista City Council District 1 race is now separated by just 2 votes. John McCann leads Steve Padilla in an updated vote count that was posted just a short time ago. After all the votes were counted last week, the 2 candidates were tied. Then the San Diego County Registrar of Voters began manually counting ballots. Election results will be certified December 2nd. A state lawmaker wants to take the sting out of working on Thanksgiving and Christmas. Assemblywoman Lorena Gonzalez says retailers like Walmart, Macy's, and Kmart are increasingly asking people to work on the year's biggest holidays.
So what we're going to try to do with this legislation is just ensure that on those 2 days, Thanksgiving and Christmas, 2 federal holidays that we know as a country have always been preserved for the family, that workers get double time.
Walmart employee Diana McCain welcomed the news. She said it was a nice bonus.
Receiving double pay for working on Thanksgiving would be a fair thing to do for everyone who sacrifices their holiday to be here on the job for shoppers.
Gonzalez says she plans to introduce the bill before the end of the year. Folks who are driving someplace for the holiday will pay less for gas than they have in quite some time. San Diego's average price for regular is at its lowest level since October 2010. The Auto Club says it is $3.08 a gallon right now. Prices have dropped for 55 straight days. The holidays are supposed to be a joyous time, but for some, they can also bring stress, anxiety, and other illnesses. Becky Pico finds out how to avoid the holiday blues.
64% of people with diagnosed mental illness say the holidays make their condition worse. That's from a recent survey of 300 people by the National Alliance on Mental Illness. Joining me with some practical ways to reduce mental stress during the holidays is my guest, Dr. Michael Krellstein, Clinical Director of San Diego County's Behavioral Health Services. And welcome to Evening Edition.
It's nice to be here. Thank you.
Now, Dr. Krellstein, what is it about winter holidays that kind of increases people's stress and or makes them feel a little blue?
Well, for most, holidays are a joyous time. But for some, the holidays as they approach, there's also a sense of unwellness that develops. And this unwellness can take several different flavors, including feeling down or being depressed, feeling anxious or avoidant, irritable, even argumentative, or feeling like one's triggers are more exposed. The holidays are a wonderful time, but it's also a stressful time.
Is there certain things, are there key symptoms that you can say, hey, the holidays are really kind of making me feel this way?
Well, the symptoms of just recognizing and being mindful of how we feel as we meet the normal stresses. And some of those stresses, you know, there's a lot to get done. There's certain expectations. There's a lot of concentrated social time. People are together, and that can bring about more opportunities for relationship or intergenerational issues to come up, some cultural differences, even some disparities. And so it affects people.
Well, I understand that this kind of feeling down sometimes during the holiday or holiday blues, as it's called, it's not unusual. No one, of course, wants to feel that way. How can you avoid feeling down during these next few months?
Well, several things come to mind. There are some common things that you hear about. Folks have a sense of losing control many times. We get swept up in the holiday spirit and all of the activity and opportunities and the excitement. And being able to keep some sense of control around that. So that would include setting realistic goals and understanding that we have limits and that those limits include our diet and our activities and even spending or what we do with alcohol and some of the other enticements. And spending more time with friends and family, volunteering. Sometimes it's really good to turn the attention from the self to others, and there are different ways to do that.
How do you know if some of the emotions you're experiencing during this season are just kind of normal, maybe from these pressures, or if it's something more serious, specifically if you truly are depressed?
Well, it's interesting because the holiday blues can be a normal and natural thing, and usually when we get back into our normal routines and rhythms, we start having a better sense of control and our lives move forward. But for some, that sense of holiday blues linger, and for others, we actually see that during the holidays, for example, people who suffer with depression or anxiety, the holidays actually represent an opportunity for distraction, and then when and reprieve, really, from how they've been feeling. And so these are issues that are continual issues that people bring into the holidays. It goes away for a little while. Afterwards, you actually feel a little bit worse. And you kind of are wondering, maybe it might be time for to get some help.
And some of those symptoms specifically, hopeless, feeling helpless, too little, too much sleep, unusual weight loss, what else are some symptoms either during the holidays or after that you might have depression?
Right. So the symptoms of having a depressed mood most of the time, some feelings of depression or sadness are, of course, normal and completely common. But if it's most of the time, most every day, and it doesn't seem to be lifting, if there is a sense of dread or real avoidance or anxiety that's coupled with that, a sense that you can't or having trouble functioning and going on with your day. And of course, if you're feeling like maybe it's all too much and you just rather stay in bed under the covers, that might be time to reach out for help.
And also persistent suicidal thoughts, correct?
Yes.
Okay. What kind of help is available for depression or for people that are experiencing mental illness here in San Diego?
Well, we are very blessed here in San Diego County to have just a tremendous expertise of behavioral health and mental health services here in the county, whether it's public or private or academic. And people who now have more insurance because of the Affordable Care Act. And there are many different portals into the healthcare delivery system. There's one particular access point that I'd like to tell you about. It's called the County Crisis and Access Line. And when a person calls this number, you'd be met by a professional who is going to ask a few questions about your background and circumstances and will hopefully point you in the right direction. And can I give you that number?
We will have that on our website.
Perfect.
That's kpbs.org. So we are out of time, but these are excellent tips. And as you said, this portal to get into the system if you feel like you need some help. And we do have that number on our website, kpbs.org. Dr. Michael Krellstein, thank you so much.
Thank you.
You know, Thanksgiving is a time of the year when fewer poor people go hungry here in San Diego County, and that's because charities overflow with volunteers to serve hot turkey dinners to those in need. But KPBS reporter Susan Murphy looks at the 500,000 people in our county who struggle to put food on the table the rest of the year.
Thank you so much.
Picking up Thanksgiving ingredients from a food pantry is something Holly Ramos never imagined doing.
Like the mashed potatoes, the green beans, the pumpkin pie filling.
But the college-educated mother of two says money has been tight since she quit her job as a preschool teacher to care for her autistic son.
His schedule is full of services, and if I am not there, there'd be no way that he could get them, and I feel like that's where I need to focus on.
With her husband's salary as their only income, Holly comes to the food pantry at New Seasons Church in Spring Valley twice a month.
It supplements meals, fruits and vegetables and breads, so all the components of your food group are here.
Ramos is one of a 500,000 people in San Diego County who receive food assistance. Altogether, one in six people in the county struggle to get enough to eat. Many are children. A recent Feeding America report shows the county's overall hunger rate has declined slightly, but hunger among children continues to rise. Nearly a quarter of children lack enough food to eat.
Number 104? Okay, 105. Thank you. 106.
Every week, thousands line up for canned goods, dairy products, and produce at food bank distribution sites, including the Salvation Army in El Cajon.
Thank you, dear. Here you go. Thank you very much.
The East County City has the highest poverty rate in the county.
197. Thank you. Right behind there.
But hunger spans the region, even to the affluent coastal city of Del Mar.
I've been coming here for the last 4 or 5 years.
John Nogard gets food from a Feeding America distribution site at St. Peter's Episcopal Church, located along the coastal bluffs overlooking the ocean. He was a salesman up until the economic downturn in 2008.
Oh, I sold furniture and stuff like that, but when the big crash came, nobody was buying houses and nobody bought furniture then, too.
Feeding droves of people takes a network of food sources and an army of volunteers. Pam Economides has been on the front lines of fighting hunger in North County for more than 15 years.
It really makes you feel awful when you think about people who are hungry and all over the world, people who are sometimes starving and just all of the food that goes to waste.
Economides volunteers with Feeding America's food rescue program, picking up perishable food items from grocery stores that would otherwise go to waste and giving it to people in need.
We get 2 truckloads every day, and that covers 5 grocery stores. The food generally comes in banana boxes, which are filled with produce and meat, and then boxes and boxes of bread.
Feeding America partners with 160 grocery stores and retailers across the county and rescues nearly 1 million pounds of food each month.
Hunger is a solvable problem.
Jennifer Tracy is executive director of the San Diego Hunger Coalition. She says it's programs like these that are helping to close the gap of the 79 million meals that are missed each year.
We almost ended hunger at the end of the 1970s through the expansion of programs like food stamps, WIC, and senior meals. In the 80s, those programs were cut, and we saw a significant increase in hungry people.
Tracy says her passion for ending hunger started when she was a child.
I didn't go hungry as a child because of the food stamp program being available when my dad would get laid off from his construction job.
She says expanding federal food programs, increasing food stamp use, and lifting people out of poverty are key in solving the hunger crisis within 10 years.
We're looking at the projections for how is the population going to change, what's going to happen with poverty, and how much more do we need to increase the work that we're doing in order to meet the need.
The need of those like Holly Ramos in Spring Valley, who this Thanksgiving is grateful for the food she has received and to those who provided it.
You remember the next time you come in and it's like, hey, how are you? You get great big hugs, everybody sees you and they love you.
Susan Murphy, KPBS News.
Video journalist Nick McVicker helped produce that story, and you can find links to different San Diego food programs on our website. It's kpbs.org.
I'm Gwen Ifill. On the next news hour, a look at a centuries-old New Mexico Pueblo community threatened by fire and floods. That's Wednesday on the PBS News Hour.
Well, it may not be the turkey's choice, but the turkey's going to be the star of many Thanksgiving Day feasts tomorrow. Peggy Pico gets some last-minute tips from a local executive chef.
Here with some expert tips on how to make sure your Thanksgiving dinner is a success is my guest Bernard Guillas, executive chef at the Marine Room and La Jolla Beach and Tennis Club. Welcome back, Bernard.
Bonjour. Always wonderful being here.
Good to see you too. Now, before we actually get to the dinner, what can you recommend for cooks today? What should they do to sort of decrease the stress, if that's possible, before tomorrow's big feast?
Make a list. Go shopping now. Make sure that you have all your ingredients so like this you don't have to run around. So if you have your turkey, if you have your side dishes, if you are baking your pie today, if you're making your cranberry sauce today, if you're baking your stuffing today, then tomorrow it's going to be a breeze. Only cooking the turkey, and that's it.
It sounds so relaxing the way you put it that way. But when it comes to cooking a traditional turkey, let's say in the oven, how do you recommend doing that?
Well, the best thing to do is to have your dial at 325 degrees. You plan to be about, 12 to 14 minutes per pound. So that's the way you should plan it. And then what I like to do is I take butter and I give the turkey a massage with the butter and I put the spices and the fresh herbs, and then you put it in the center of the oven. And every 10 to 15 minutes, you take that butter and you baste. Make sure that you are basting all the time. And then rotate the turkey, because most likely there is a hot spot in your oven.
Okay, I am seeing a video of you stuffing the turkey with, it looks like, herbs. Should you put stuffing and or herbs or anything in your turkey?
You can put stuffing if you want to, but most likely what will happen is the stuffing needs to go to 165 degrees. So it means that you have a big chance that you will overcook the breast and you overcook the bird. What I like to do in the cavity, onions, celery, aromatic vegetable, garlic, for example, sage, and this will just infuse the whole oven. That's what's great about it. It's like, you know, aromatherapy. Every time that you open the oven, you have that, ah, and everybody, when they come in the house, they are so happy to be there because it's, you just can't wait.
You get so good, you know? Great. Let's talk about side dishes, which are my absolute favorite. Is there one or two that you could offer a twist on, let's say, your basic mashed potatoes or green beans or something like that?
I'm going to give you the basic for the mashed potato. You need to make sure that you use, let's say, russet potatoes is the best one. High starch, really good. You have to start it cold water, always cold water, and sea salt. You bring it into a simmer. When they are tender, you mash it. Creme fraiche, mascarpone, butter, yummy. Salt, pepper, boom, you're done. If you want to play with sweet potato, boniato, it's a sweet potato from Cuba, available pretty much everywhere. And you finish it with a little bit of butter, maple syrup, and a little bit of spiced rum. You can also use purple potatoes.
And the spiced rum is okay because the alcohol, so the little ones at the kids' table can eat.
Yes, because the alcohol will cook up. But the other thing you could do is play with something that's going to be different. Root vegetables such as celery root. It is sweet, it's delicious, roast really well. Do some parsnips, some rutabaga. Just change it a little bit.
And that will be fun. Let's talk about vegetables. So if, let's say you're having vegetarians over and you want to serve something besides salad or mashed potatoes, as good as that sounds, what can you do there?
I'll tell you, I use tofurkey. Tofurkey, for example, so it's like a tofu turkey, I would say, but it's all tofu. But the thing is, you can still do a lot of the basting and the basting that you would do, you do it with, I do a soy, tangerine, a little bit of honey, and it's kind of Asian flavor. It's really good. When it comes to vegetables, you still can do a lot of your, go to the farmer's market. I mean, there is gorgeous green beans right now. So if you do your green beans, you do your roots, you look at heirloom carrots, you can roast all this with extra virgin olive oil and fresh herb. It's delicious.
Super fresh and super
grains.
Delicious.
Do you look at your grain, your quinoa, all your super grain, and it's really wonderful.
And we'll have to end on this one, but some heart healthy suggestions. So people who want to eat a little bit healthier and still enjoy their Thanksgiving dinner.
You know, talking about different grain, look at doing, for example, a wild rice, sun-dried apricot, sun-dried cranberries, and you add to this your sliced haricot vert, for example, and that would be just fantastic. So you can use all the vegetables that we talked about, and it would be just nice and balanced. But don't forget, even if you want it heart healthy, you still need to have a pie.
You have to have a pie. Well, okay, I can't let that go. What is the pie?
You know, just that beautiful pumpkin pie, but use different pumpkin. Don't get stuck on one pumpkin. You can do kabocha, you can do sweet potato pie, you can do, you know, I saw some cherries. There were still some cherries the other day. You can do a cherry pie, you can do apple pie, pecan pie.
Okay.
You can do all the pie in the world.
I am so hungry right now. We are out of time. I want to let people know that we have one of your recipes for a Thanksgiving turkey our website, kpbs.org. Chef Bernard Guillas, thank you and happy Thanksgiving.
My pleasure. But don't forget, toast everything with a nice glass of rosé. Because rosé is a perfect pairing for that whole meal.
All right. Thank you. I'm hungry.
My pleasure. Happy Thanksgiving, everyone.
And just like the oven, the weather's going to be a little bit warm on Thanksgiving Day. And then temperatures going to start dropping. Low 80s along the coast tomorrow, down to the upper 60s by Saturday. It's going to be a bit warmer in the inland valleys. Sunny, but cooler in the mountains. Low 80s out in the deserts tomorrow. Recapping tonight's top story, a protest is kind of gathering in City Heights tonight over a grand jury's decision in Missouri. A decision not to charge a white police officer in the fatal shooting of a black teenager. KPBS reporter Megan Burks is at the protest site, and she joins us again by phone. Megan, what's going on where you're at?
I am now on the I-15 overpass on University Avenue in City Heights. About 100 to 150 demonstrators marched from the park on Fairmont and Landis to the street. Yesterday was a very different scene. They actually walked on to Interstate 15. Now there are highway patrol officers blocking all on and off ramps. This protest seems a bit calmer than it was last night. In fact, it took a little while to get going. We talked to some people earlier when things were a bit calmer in City Heights. Let's go to them.
We don't have that major feelings of injustice here, and so maybe that's why there's not such a great turnout. I mean, it's great that they're here in support of them and that, but maybe it doesn't affect people's personal lives here maybe as much. So.
It's worthwhile to protest over this type of thing anywhere, because the only way we're going to get heard is if we put our voices out there. And if we got to protest to put our voices out there, that's how we do it.
And so things seem to be a little bit calmer out there tonight than they were last night. But this protest is going to go on for a little while. Is that right, Megan?
Yeah, it's scheduled to go until 9 o'clock. Last night it actually went until past midnight. So we don't really know what's going to happen. We're walking westbound on University Avenue. All we do know is that protesters tonight seem to be committed to keeping the peace. There was a pep talk beforehand saying to be smart and be peaceful.
And we've got about a minute or so left, Megan. Can you tell us briefly why this protest is happening in the City Heights area?
Sure. City Heights is a very diverse community. In the past, people here have spoken out about feeling that they've been racially profiled by police officers. That is something that Chief Shelley Zimmerman has been working on. Police officers in this community now wear pop cams on their chests. And there's also monthly meetings where the residents can help tell police officers what they think about their patrolling.
KPBS reporter Megan Burks live in City Heights tonight monitoring a protest there. You can find tonight's stories on our website, kpbs.org/eveningedition. We want to thank you very much for joining us this evening, and we hope you have a great night.